Brothers and sisters in Dhamma, good evening. Welcome to BGF. My name is Bobby Ng. I'm the Dhamma Tutor Exco here. And tonight's forum is called a Dhamma and Science Forum, entitled Inner Traffic and Spacious Mind. The panelists will consist of Acharya Upul and Brother Billy Tan. So this forum seeks to examine how the mind is cluttered with endless activity and how we can cultivate peace and tranquility from within through the practice of meditation and also explore it from a scientific perspective. Acharya Upul Nishanta Gamage is Sri Lanka's foremost lay meditation teacher and is the principal of Nilambe Buddhist Meditation Center in Kandy. In his travels around the globe, Acharya Upul has been guiding thousands of people in learning and practicing meditation and has been a great spiritual friend and outstanding Dhamma teacher to countless people in his mission to bring more kindness, compassion, happiness and peace to the world. Now, how many of you know about Bhante Sujata, who was here recently? So Bhante Sujata and Acharya Upul learned meditation from the same teacher in Sri Lanka, right? Yeah. They are very good friends. Now, Brother Billy Tan, the other panelist, is a life member of BGF and a panel speaker in the K. Sri Dhammananda lecture series since 2012. He offers Dhamma sharing and professional training programs to community centers and charity organizations in Malaysia, Philippines, and other countries in sharing the Dhamma. Billy also goes to Philippines to do Dhamma tours. Brother Billy studies under the guidance of Venerable Punaji and enjoys connecting findings from neuroscience and psychology to present the Buddha's teachings from a scientific and modern perspective. So this will be a forum style. I'll leave it to Brother Billy to do the moderation and the contact. Let's give that a big hand.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening, brothers and sisters in the Dhamma. We're very happy to share this evening's Dhamma session. It will be a session on Dhamma and science. So we're going to look at the teachings of the Buddha, how it can help us cultivate our mind for peace, tranquility, and of course, happiness in life. And at the same time, I'm going to share with you some findings from the field of psychology and neuroscience to help support the teachings of the Buddha. You'll be surprised that the Buddha actually has been talking about stuff which only in recent years, psychologists and neuroscientists are beginning to discover and realize. And the topic of mind is something which is not easy to explain. And scientists have been struggling to explain mind. If you ask 10 different scientists from various disciplines, you're probably going to get 10 different definitions. You know, what is the mind? And there are many things about the mind which the Buddha has actually spoken about throughout his 45 years of teaching. So tonight we're going to share some of these, and I shall hand the mic to Acharya Upul Gamage to begin. So Acharya, please proceed.
Thank you very much, dear Brother Billy. Dear brothers and sisters, first I would like to express my gratefulness to all of you to come for this sharing. We are here today not to teach anything, but to share some of our experiences. When Brother Billy said that what is the mind, and actually no one can give a right and perfect answer for this question, what is the mind, what the mind is. It is an eternal question. It is an eternal problem. And there are a hundred of answers. But still that question is remaining. It is there still. And there was a time in the last century, there was a big argument about mind and matter. And some, especially scientists, said there is no mind, only matter. And some ideologists said there is only mind, no matter. And this argument goes on and on. And you may know that one of the very famous philosophers, Bertrand Russell, he was asked by so many people about this, what is mind and what is matter? And he was fed up with this question. Therefore, finally he found an answer for this question, very beautiful answer. Whenever people ask, what is mind? He said, no matter. And what is mind? What is matter? Never mind. What is matter? Never mind. What is mind? No matter. And that's a very wise answer. Without knowing what's the matter, what's the mind, we make a lot of conflicts, even with our own mind. Where is the mind? This is another very famous question. If mind is there, then tell us, where is it? Is it in the brain? Is it in the heart? Or is it somewhere out of the body? They are very interesting questions, but no answers for that. Because this word mind, it's a noun. According to the Buddhism, mind is not a noun. It's a verb. Therefore, if you are looking for an answer from Buddhist point of view for this question, this is the best and simple and perfect answer. There is no mind. There is no mind. Then why we are talking about this? Then what the mind is, if there is no mind? Is there only body? No, not only body. Now I am talking and you can hear, you can listen. Because it is audio experience, therefore all of you can experience it. And I am sitting here with Brother Billy and you can see it. They are sitting here, sitting together, because it is visible experience. And if we walk, again you can see they are walking. So whatever we do with the body and our words, you can see and you can hear. Therefore, one can think in this way, only verbal and physical activities are there. Only verbal and physical. That's all. But that's not all. There are non-verbal and non-physical activities. Maybe more than physical and verbal activities. Like remembering. It is not purely physical action or verbal action. If you ask from me, Upul, what are you doing now? I may say, I am remembering something. And you can ask, Upul, can you prove it that you are remembering something? I can't prove it. How possible to prove it? But still I am remembering it. I know that I am remembering, but I can't prove it because you can't hear it and you can't see it. And I can make a plan for tomorrow how to go to the airport in the early morning. And if you ask what am I doing, Upul, now, I can say I am planning, I make a plan for tomorrow morning. Oh no, we can't see anything that you are doing like planning. Yes, you can't see. But there is an activity called planning, make plans. And I can appreciate you. You are sitting here very beautifully still. And you are very relaxed, so I can appreciate. But I can't, it is not visible, that appreciation. I have to say that I am appreciating you. And you have to believe me, because you can't see my appreciation. And maybe I can judge, they are very good people, very devoted. I can judge, but judging is also not visible and not hearing. And I can feel. So there are so many non-physical and non-verbal actions we do. So instead of saying mind, we can say there are three kinds of activities. Physical activities and verbal activities and non-physical and non-verbal activities. Then no problem, nobody can ask this question, what is the mind and where is the mind? So, then we need a long title for that, non-physical and non-verbal activities. Therefore, Buddha said, mind, for this, only for this, dear friends, not for anything else. Whenever the Buddhism speaks about the mind, it is only for non-physical and non-verbal activities. And you can make a huge list of non-physical and non-verbal activities. I just say a couple of activities, but lot of like observation, reflection, many activities. The interesting thing is, even the mind doesn't know how many things that it can do. Or even we don't know how many things we can do with our mind. Or how many things we can do, how many non-physical and non-verbal activities we can do. Nobody knows. Unlimited activities are there. Unlimited. Therefore, the Dhamma says, Buddhism says, this subject of mind is unthinkable. Unthinkable. There are unthinkable subjects, like if you start to think about this universe and world systems, solar systems, you can think, but there is no limit. It is unthinkable. Infinity subject. And Karma is also unlimited subject, unthinkable subject. And mind itself is also an unthinkable subject, infinity subject. And dear friends, therefore, we are doing many psychological or mental activities at once. Not only one activity, not only one after one, not only one by one. Many activities. We can't do many or multiple activities with our body or with our words. That is not possible. The body can do only one or maximum two together. Talking is also one action. But psychologically, we can do many activities at once. And we may think it's a skill to do many mental, psychological or emotional actions together. But actually, it is not a skill. It is an unskillfulness. As with meditation, what we are learning to do is one action at once, one by one, one by one. Brother Billy has a very beautiful and very, I think, latest computer here. And he is doing so many things, amazing things with this notebook. Yes. He's recording and displaying and making photos and publishing photos, so many things, downloading. And you may all have computers. And what happens if you ask your computer to do many actions at once, if you ask it to do this and this and this, that, then what happens to your computer? It can't do even one thing. It is stuck. It is being stuck. It tries to do everything. Whatever you ask, it tries to do, but it is unable to do. Then the result is, it is being stuck. And then, what we have to do is, we have to shut down the computer. For a while, we have to shut down it and wait. And there are no any other solution for that. We have to shut down and wait and restart. Today, dear friends, we experience same thing with our busy lifestyle. Busy lifestyle. Today, as a modern human, we are not busy with our body. Our body is so lazy today. So lazy. Doing nothing actually compared to the past. We do nothing with our body. We don't have to chop the firewood today. Unless if you come to Nilambe Meditation Center, then of course you have to chop the firewood. Otherwise, no need. You have to just press a key. Then fire comes. Like a magic. And water comes. We don't have to carry water today. You have to just touch and then water comes. And just touch, then the light comes. So when I press the button, then after 1, 2, 3 seconds, I was in the second floor. It's a miracle. But in the past, no. We had to walk. We had to climb. Compared to the past, today, physically, we do nothing. Physically, we do nothing. But Compared to the past, today we are so busy with doing nothing. By doing nothing, we are so busy. So this busyness is actually not related to the mind, to the body, sorry, but it is related to the mind. Mentally, we are so busy. We all are aware on the desire for food, desire for movies, desire for songs, desire for dress, desire for this and that. They all are desires, and we are craving for all these things. But the most and subtle desire is not for these things, not for food, not for movies, not for dress, for information, for new information. But we don't think it's a desire. It's a desire, it's a very subtle desire, but very strong desire, desire for information, desire for knowing about this and knowing about that, and to know about what is happening in next country, neighbor country, in America, in England, in next galaxy. We have that desire. Because of this desire, we collect information and data by reading newspapers, by watching television, by listening to radios, and by using internet. What we do is also by talking to others and listening to others, we collect information. Just think that our stomach is so small, so it has its own limit. So when we feed to our stomach and we come to one point that we are full, no more hungry, so we can't feed anymore. If we feed any more, then some digesting problems come. Then even the body cannot absorb the energy of the food. Then the system collapses. Same thing happens to our mind. But we are not aware about it. The mind doesn't need all this information. The brain doesn't need all this information. It has its own limit. But what we do is, unnecessarily we feed to ourselves with all this information. From morning, whenever we get up, till when we go to the bed, till the last moment before we sleep, what we do is, we always feed information to ourselves. And then mind doesn't know what it can do with all this information. And actually, those informations, most of informations are not pleasant. This is the other thing, not pleasant and not peaceful. About violence, about crimes, about injustice. And then mind doesn't know what it can do with all these informations, but mind wants to do something. Then mind tries to then actually what happens to the mind is, mind becomes a court or judge. And then whenever we hear some incident which happened in, not maybe here, in somewhere else, then what the mind tries to do is to make a court case. Who is right? Who is wrong? So mind becomes a judge. And mind doesn't need to know about the full incident, to make a judgment. One small information is more than enough to make a judgment for our mind. Because mind is busy to go to the next court case, next one. And mind thinks that it knows how to make judgment. And also mind thinks the mind is a qualified judge. With this mentality and with this behavior, dear friends, what happens is our mind is a court complex now. Complex of court cases. And then we go to the bed to sleep with all these court cases. During the daytime, we don't have time to think about this and that. We only feed. So mind doesn't have time to understand and digest and absorb and come to conclusion about all this information during the daytime because we are busy. And whenever we go to the bed to sleep, only then mind finds time. And then what the mind is doing, I think we all experience this, what the mind is doing, it recalls to all this information one by one, what it heard or seen in the morning, during the daytime, and tries to think and analyze and make judgment and punish to people. So with this judging mind, dear friends, nobody can sleep. Nobody can sleep with this judging mind. And nobody is paying for this job. This is the other thing. Nobody is paying. It's a self-appointment. And we have to pay for this job. We have to pay for newspapers, for television, for internet connection, for everything. And we want to punish to others. Actually, we don't know if they are still alive or not. We just heard, we just see it. And we want to punish. By punishing others, we punish to ourselves. This is the thing what happens to us. We are in a prison. Psychologically and emotionally, we are in a prison now. If we behave as a judge, then we are in a prison. We are not free. We can't sleep. Dear friends, please be aware on that desire, that craving for unnecessary information, unnecessary data. When you go to a shop to buy something, you ask this question, do I really need it to buy? If not, you don't buy. You have money, but you ask this question, do I really want it? If yes, then you buy. If not, you don't buy. But for information, we don't ask this question, do I really want to know about it? Therefore, now our brain, our mind, maybe brain, is full. It's full. That's why we feel this heaviness of living, heaviness of the life. And we say life is heavy. This is the nature of the life. That is not the nature of the life, dear friends. Life itself is so light originally. Originally, life itself is so light, but why we cannot experience that original nature of lightness? Because too many unnecessary information and programs are running in our mind. Therefore, living is so problematic thing, so heavy thing. Like we are standing on our head. If you do this exercise, like standing on your head, it is a good exercise, but we can't do anything with this posture. If you try to do something, if you try to read a book, or if you try to speak to somebody, or if you try to walk, if you try to do some complicated thing like cooking or something, it's impossible while you are standing on your head. So we experience our life like that now. So heavy head, so heavy mind. Unfortunately, we always think in the opposite way. We think the body is heavier than the mind because body is solid, body is physical, and body is materialistic. Therefore, we think it is so heavy. The body is heavy. And you can measure it, 50 kilos, 60, 70, 80. But we can't measure the mind weight. But it is actually, in experiential level, it is more heavier than the body, the mind. Especially when we are emotional. When we are emotional. And sometimes we see people, when they walk like this. But visibly nothing, physically nothing is on their shoulders, on their head. But something like invisible, 100 or 200 kilos is on their shoulders or head. Therefore, we are not relaxed. We can't do anything in a relaxed way. And even we can't use our mind for necessary things today. Because we abuse our mind to do unnecessary things. We misuse our mind. And the last thing what I want to share with you, dear friends, today, before the discussion and before the Brother Billy's presentation. We think that there are three times, past, present and future. And do you ever think this question, where is the past? Where is it? Is it in the calendar? Can you find the past in any calendar? Any diary? The past is not anywhere. We can't find the past. It's a memory. The past is a memory. If you can remember something which happened in yesterday, then yesterday is there. If you cannot remember anything what you have done in day before yesterday, then day before yesterday is not there. So the past is a memory. And it is in your mind. It is not anywhere else. And future is same. It is not in your calendars or in your reminders. It is a plan. If you have a plan for tomorrow, then tomorrow is there. If you don't have any plan for tomorrow, then no tomorrow. But if you have a plan for day after tomorrow, then day after tomorrow is there. So future and past are just thoughts. Just thoughts. We don't understand this. Because of this misunderstanding or no understanding or wrong understanding, what we do is, whenever we remember something, we use that memory as a vehicle to go to the past. Whenever we remember something, then we use that memory, that thought, as a vehicle to go to the past. And so after that, we use that thought as a house to live in the past. So we do both. First we use memories as vehicles for time traveling to go to the past. And then we use that memory as a house to live inside of it, as a hut. So we always do this. We go to the past and live in the past. And whenever an expectation or plan comes to our mind, then we use that thought as a vehicle to go to the future and live in the future. So we do same thing. Dear friends, always either we are in the past or in the future. Always we are in one of these tours. Going to the past or going to the future. Living in the past or living in the future. This makes us so busy. This makes your mind so busy. So busy. Therefore, you miss this present moment. You miss the light of the present moment. Calmness of the present moment, freedom of the present moment, and space of the present moment. We all miss that. The Dhamma once said, the Buddha once said this, it is in the Dhamma. If nobody is in front of you and nobody is behind you, then you can walk freely. Because space is there in front of you. If you want to walk faster, you can walk faster. If you want to slow down your walk, you can slow down your walk. And if nobody is behind you, then no pressure. Even if you want to stop your walk, you can stop. Nobody is behind you, nobody makes any pressure. Just imagine, today we came from Malacca, Brother Billy drives very, very, very beautifully. You're driving. Really, I enjoy it. Sometimes a huge, long queue. So many cars behind us, so many cars in front of us. So we had to control our speed. No choice. We don't have any choice then. So Dhamma said, this very practical example, what the Dhamma said, if nobody is in front of you and nobody is behind you, then you are so free. Same, if you do not project anything for the future and nothing is behind you, if you are living in the present, only then you can experience spacious mind. So much space. But at the moment, we can't experience such a space because these two journeys are making so much pressure. We are jammed now because of these two unnecessary tours. But fortunately, we can return to the present. Yes, we go to the past and we live in the past and we make a lot of emotions because of those past incidents. And we go to the future and we are anxious sometimes. But fortunately, we can return to the present. And I met many people who are unable to return to the present. When I visit psychiatric wards, they are permanently now living in the past or living in the future, and no way to return. They lost the path, the return way. Therefore, no present for them. No present at all. And no medicine for that. I don't know any medicine is there for that. No medicine. They are in psychiatric wards forever. So, dear friends, don't disconnect yourself with the present. Why we are still able to return to the present? Because we all have at least minimum amount of mindfulness, minimum amount of awareness, sati. Because of that, we can return to the present. And if we lose that mindfulness, that minimum mindfulness, then we are unable to return. And no solution for that. So, this is the solution given by the Dhamma, Buddhism. Be mindful, be aware, and always be in the present. Always be in the present. You can remember your past, but remembering is a present action. It is not a past action, it is a present action. And you can make a plan for future. Making a plan is also a present action. Therefore, dear friend, it is a skill. It's a skill to be in the present. Then, only then you can remember your past very well without being emotional. And you can make very perfect plans for future only by living in the present. Only then you can experience spacious mind. Don't lose it and don't miss it. Thank you very much, dear friends.